Well, good morning, everyone. Really nice to be here. I've been on a little bit of a roller coaster trip, flying in on a red eye to Boston, I think a week ago, and just been slammed morning, afternoon, and night since then, from Boston, New York, Connecticut, Baltimore, and then home later this afternoon, back to Oregon, time for Father's Day. So yes, I will be speaking on personalized diet with an emphasis on managing, potentially preventing cancer and optimizing health and wellness. And so I've been in the field for, as a clinician for 30 years now, but I've been in the field for over 40 years before that. And my first love has been food as medicine. That's how I got started. And so I've seen every diet under the sun there. And so we can see all the trends, you know, gluten-free, grain-free, no carb, low carb, no fat, low fat, raw, macrobiotic, you know, vegan, paleolithic, macrobiotic, ketogenic, caloric restricted, and then finally breatharianism. If you ever read Survival into the 21st Century, is one of the first books I ever read. There was a chapter called breatharianism, which means sunshine for lunch, basically. You know, you stop eating. And so I'm always also very interested for people to actually share what they eat. People love to say, I don't eat this, I don't eat that. And I said, all right, I don't care if you eat gluten-free or not gluten-free. I want to know what you're actually eating. Because it can, is it healthy or is it unhealthy? Is it balanced or is it not balanced? And then people are so confused. I mean, look at these two here. Snow White was poisoned by an apple. Jack found a giant in his beanstalk. And look what happened to Alice when she ate the mushroom. And so you wonder why people won't eat fruits and vegetables, you know? So we say one size does not fit all, you know? And this is one of my favorite quotes. The extremes of both self-indulgence and self-deprivation have equally harmful consequences for human life. They result in the distortion that alienates and even kills the spirit, which is ultimately what we live for. You know, everything has to be engaging our spiritual self, our emotional self, our intellectual self, and our physical self. You have to harmonize all of those aspects together. So according to the most recent review, you know, 90 to 95% of diets actually fail. That's the data has come out on that. 41% of people actually gain back the weight they've lost after 1 year. 41%. And a lot of people are miserable on the various diets that they chose to do. Yo-yo diet cycle, deprivation, rebellion, rebound weight gain, craving, food obsessions. Often diets slow your metabolism down. So sometimes you go so caloric restrictive that your body adapts and slows your metabolism down even more. And then often just a short-term solution. So what you want to do is engage in a healthy relationship with everything, you know, with nature, with your fellow human beings, and with the food you eat, you know, with nature, and have that relationship be good on all levels. So here is my most recent book, which has a whole chapter called Eating for Optimal Health. And I also have a blog, which you can't see there, which is just my name, Donnie, spelled with an I-E, Y-A-N-C-E.com. And that's the one outreach I do to the general public. And I have recipes in there. I have all kinds of papers that I write week after week that are written in terms that are digestible by the public. A couple of weeks ago, I did three blogs on thyroid health. I did two on weight management. I did one on sunchokes, one of my favorite food, which we'll actually talk about. So the latest research evaluating 24 cross-selectional studies found that intuitive eating was associated with less disordered eating, a positive body image, and a healthier emotional function. So I often tell people, look into the slow food movement, plant a garden, eat from it. Many people with digestive problems, it's not always just about what you're eating, but how you're eating, why you're eating. You have to ask all of those questions. You have to relax when you eat. You know, it's part of the digestive process. So what intuitive eating, it can actually be summarized into three general characteristics. Unconditional permission to eat when you're hungry and what food type. or even food if desired. It should be real whole food. So always try to make whatever food group you eat the closest from nature, the closest from the earth as possible. As soon as we do anything to food, no matter what we think, we're usually creating that food from a very healthy food to an unhealthy food. Even when we think we take fat out of food, we think we're making it healthy, we're not. You know, when we take this out of food, this that out of the food, it's best to stay as close to nature and as whole as possible. Eating for physical and spiritual needs and cravings rather than just emotional. So always check in. You know, the first impulse is this is what I crave, but really just check in, think it through, and then even sometimes just say a little prayer and just say, is this really what I want to be ingesting? And if it is through that whole process, then embrace it, you know. Reliance on internal hunger, clues to determine when and how much to eat. So this is kind of just a better understanding, basically a better relationship with the food you ingest. So this model that I've created, kind of the architect, but I don't want it to be my model, I want it to be a we model. And so I call it the eclectic triphasic medical system. You know, my whole approach to cancer is not the Donnie Yance approach, it's the Madiri approach. And so it's a whole systems model, it's integrative, it's adaptive, and it's personalized. And it's bridging botanical nutritional medicine with often multi-targeted pharmaceutical medicine, as well as dietary and lifestyle. The convergency of everything we can do to get people well and keep them well. And one of the ways that we figure things out, even when it comes to diet, is applying what's called critical thinking. And critical thinking is actively and skillfully conceptualizing, applying, analyzing, synthesizing, and/or evaluating information gathered from or generated by observation, experience, reflection, reasoning, communication as a guide to belief and action. So in other words, the best way to help people, even with diet, is develop a relationship. It really takes a relationship to understand all the nuances. And in that relationship, also part of the healing takes place, the interaction. So in this approach, we basically have three main targets. And then we have the target one, and this applies to how you eat, and particularly when it applies to cancer. So one is to focus on the person, which is the host. This is a little schematic or icon that depicts the energetic makeup of who we are, looking at the three energies, essence, force, and spirit, the five major organ systems, the balance of inward and outward energy, or yin and yang energy, and then the influence of the landscape, which is our external environment, what we're living in, what factors contribute around us, either past, present, or potentially future. The second is the microenvironment, which is mostly when you go in for your blood work or urine test, that's kind of analyzing that environment. You know, what we can gather through observation, symptoms, relationship, also possibly people doing pulse reading, all of that goes under host diagnosis. When we do blood work, you can't get that information from blood work, and what you get from the host diagnosis, you can't extrapolate through blood work. And so they each serve a different purpose. And so in the microenvironment, the idea here is to create an environment that's optimal to the host by altering that. And then assessing it and see what factors in that environment might be contributing to disease and altering it. And then we assess the tumor genomics as well. So understanding everything we can about the cancer, you know, and then ultimately seeing if the cancer is a more aggressive or more advanced cancer, it has to manipulate the microenvironment. So we're also assessing the microenvironment to see what clues that the cancer has hijacked to manipulate that environment. So the idea is to put your toolboxes to work by working on the host, by working on the microenvironment, and then targeting the tumor as well. And so these are all the different biomarkers or ways of assessing host symptoms, observation, palpation, energetics, blood, urine testing, and then tissue-based profiling as well. And in here, when you're looking at the host, you're also examining the external environment. And the idea with the environment around you, what kind of stressors you have, what your work environment's like, what your home environment's like. Maybe in the past, were you exposed to some sort of chemical exposure? And so looking at this environment here, and there's two things that we look at it for. One is to say, ask the question, can we change that environment and make it healthier? And if we can't, can we put things in with our toolboxes to better protect us to the stressors of those environment of that environment has on us? And then things, all of this can ultimately lead to depression, anxiety, distress, ultimately chronic disease as well. So just a little bit on stress. Stress, anxiety, and depression are linked to chronic disease and serious health conditions. So these are all different issues that come about because of increased stress levels. And one of the big ones even is neurodegenerative disease and even dementia. So here you can see here, these ladies are having a little talk. She says, my memory is so bad. And the other lady asked, how bad is it? And she goes, how bad is what? She already forgot. So here we have stress in the physical environment. So this is very, very important as the world we live in is so evolving so rapidly and changing that we look at all four of these levels and where we're at within ourselves, our own internal relationship within ourselves, then interpersonal, very close people, our spouse, our children, our family, our very close linked friends, then our community, our bigger group of people, and then the world around us. And nowadays, people know very little about themselves, have very little relationship with their family and close friends, and even outreach to the community. Their whole idea is everything is based the world. They're plugged into the internet or their television, and that's the relationship. There's a whole disconnect to here, this hierarchy, and this is where we should be. It should always be here, 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 and then maybe here. And we change the world by small changes with the people around us. And so the individual is surrounded and influenced by multi-relationships and various levels. All humans need three things: to give love, receive love, and feel a sense of belonging. Those are the three requirements of spiritual nourishment. And not just one, you can't just receive love. You have to be giving love, and then you also have to feel a sense. When people often get older, they don't feel a sense of purpose anymore. And you have to feel that I'm, you know, that who I am in the world is connected. And so important questions to ponder about eating. So like I said, what do you eat? Why do you eat? When do you eat? How do you eat? Where do you eat? And who do you eat with? These are all relative and important. And so here is a beautiful photo of a meal being eaten by a family out on a mountaintop in Sardinia, Italy, one of the blue zones where people live the longest and the healthiest. For every one American male that makes it to 100, 30 in Sardinia make it to 100. And there are, you know, no hospitals, no clinics, you know, there it's a countryside, you know. So happiness is a final end or goal that encompasses the totality of one's life. It is the ultimate purpose of human existence. So everything we do has to have that understanding of happiness, that connection. And for me, you know, people always say, you know, to me, bread gets a bad rap, but bread is the most fundamentally satisfying of all food. And that was James Beard. And I'll have a little bit more on it, you know, a nice, beautiful whole grain bread. And then now there's, you know, going back to kind of like how we think and then how our digestion works and that relationship. So do you know that how you think changes the microbiome of your flora and your digestion? Poor microflora can alter how you think. It's like a two-way street. And so you can see here very well that bacteria in the gut and cells in the brain communicate with each other. And you can see the different types of organisms in the gut and the correlation to the neurotransmitter that it correlates to. And so it's really, really interesting. And a lot of people under a lot of stress get disrupted bacteria because of chaos here. And then they get GI tract problems. And then they think often it's all about what they eat. I mean, I've had people say they're allergic to everything under the sun. and then they take a trip over to Europe and Italy, you know, to Italy or France, and they eat everything they're said they're allergic to, and they have no allergy problems. They digest everything fine. So again, it's because they're sitting down, they're eating, they're relaxed, and everything is changing because of that. So chronic stress and anxiety can lead to insulin resistance, which is epidemic in our country and a leading factor in both the cause of chronic disease, including cancer, and the progression of cancer as well. There are many, many factors that contribute within the environment that's created with insulin resistance, which simply means the inefficiency of insulin to drive glucose into the cell for energy transfer. And there are many things that contribute to that: poor diet, lack of physical activity. A big one is sleep deprivation, and as well as stress. You know, because I've had people say, "Oh my gosh, you know, I'm eating perfect. I exercise." Actually, I have one physician that I work with, and he just works really hard. But he gets up like 5 a.m. to exercise, and he goes, eats impeccably well, thin guy, and he still has glucose and insulin issues. And then I got him to actually exercise less, start taking yoga, and just get into a more relaxed state, and all of his markers normalized, and we're doing great. And he says, "Oh, if I don't exercise enough, it's gonna get worse." I said, "No, you're overdoing it. You know, it's like reverse." And the more stressed you are, the more sympathetic, so the more energy your body is demanding based on the hormones, the more sugar it's gotta make as well. You know, it's like a car that's always running on fast speed. You know, it's just burning more exhaust, and burning more fuel and creating more exhaust. And so there has to be balance to everything we do. And then the hypothalamus bridge, and so a key function of the hypothalamus is to connect the nervous system and the endocrine system together. And for years, obviously my book has a lot of emphasis on the importance of adaptogens on nourishing the endocrine system, but I would say if I rewrote my book right today, which is only not even 2 years old, I think, I would put as much importance on botanical nervines as I do on adaptogens. That was probably where I just feel like our nervous systems also need to be nourished as well, as much as our endocrine system. They're so networked together. And so what we use is botanical nervines combined with specific amino acids, B vitamins, and then diet and lifestyle modification. Very simple thing, lavender baths with Epsom salts in it. One of the most wonderful nourishing things for your nervous system. So at the heart, and we're always trying to shift the thought process, you know, basically to create more optimism, kindness, patience, forgiveness, laughter, joy, community, family, and ultimately love, and kind of move away from pessimism, depression, anger, anxiety, impatience, frustration. Most of these things are choices. We always have a choice on how we choose to respond. And most of the time people say, "Well, you know, this person's being really angry." I said, most people that are upset and angry want it to be contagious. They want other people to join into that. And it's always a choice. You know, and it's so, all of these things are so damaging to your health. A new way of understanding, this may be a little bit more technical for a second, but then I'm kind of really gonna get into the food, but it's called the quality control theory of aging and age-related diseases, and it looks at basically four things. And this is very connected to cancer as well. One is basically inadequate protein processing, the inefficiency of how we use our amino acids, cellularly speaking, which is the way protein breaks down into amino acids, histone deacetylase, the process of genomic histone and gene silencing. So it's basically how well our genes are functioning. And then suppressed what's called AMPK, which is the efficiency of energy transfer. So AMPK is a very important process in our body on how we utilize all of those nutrients we take in. And then lastly, what's called the beta adrenergic receptor, which is really the impact that the high output of sympathetic nervous system has on our health, and also shortened lifespan and being a driver of many diseases. So reprogramming these systems to maintain efficiency would be a rational strategy for increasing lifespan, targeting chronic disease, and improving total health. And that's one of the words I most like to use when we look at the toolbox of natural medicine, botanical medicine, and nutritional medicine, the way I think, is to better increase efficiency throughout the body, better increase response, not dictate function. You know, so we're helping the body respond better to anything that might be problematic. We're helping it recover better, and we're helping restore the innate life force within all living beings. And then we're also trying to create better efficiency on every level. And this is just another little one explaining that, so I'll move on here. And then our toolbox is here. We're gonna focus, spokes on a wheel is what I call it. You know, all of those things working together. This is where the puzzle all fits together, and you do see over and over again better and better health outcomes in people when you put all of these pieces together, because all of these toolboxes do different things. One does something the other can't. And so how do we personalize a diet with somebody with cancer? Well, here's how I break it down. And this looks, oh my gosh, this is complex, you know, this is, you know, but everybody wants things to be easy. They get on the internet and it has a diet, this is what you do. This requires relationship. And then I always like people to think in terms of a long-term commitment to their healthy lifestyle, something they can grow with and get better and better, not something you do for a month or 6 months and say, I can't do this anymore, and you're just back to the same way of eating and living. I'd rather have people just grow into it and embrace a really good relationship. So one, which we'll talk about next, is the constitutional and energetic makeup of that person. And I'll get into that. And that's all about observation, boosting the essence, the force, the spirit, working on the organ systems, the different body types people have. The second is called nutrigenomics, which is a new way of understanding the relationship between the phytonutrients, the compounds in food that have influence over our genes. And then how we are all different genetically, we're all different genotypes, and how we all, when we eat, may eat the same food, it may have a different effect on us because of our background. Sometimes cost availability. We have to make things affordable for people. Often. Acute conditions with people with cancer, myelosuppression, cachexia, GI tract inflammation, you know, kidney issues, liver toxicity, electrolyte imbalances, osteopenia, osteoporosis. There are so many issues that we have to address, and diet can be adapted based on that information as well. And then a perfect diet, if someone's severely anemic, what you do dietary-wise to treat their anemia, once their anemia is gone, you don't have to keep doing it. So you keep adapting your diet based on what's presented. Environment. So if you live in a tropical area or you live in Alaska, your diet should be different. You shouldn't be on the same diet. And then what time of year it is. You always should have changes in your diet, summer, winter, spring, and fall. And you say, well, what should it be? Common sense will tell you. Look at what's coming into season. You know, if you were a traditional people living anywhere else in the world, the foods, every couple of weeks, the foods at the farm stand change. And we say, and we like that because it gives us variety, but there's also interesting, nature has a way of building certain things into those foods that are really adaptive to our ability to adapt to the environment as it changes. You know, for hot weather, we see cooling foods like melons and cucumbers. You know, colder weather for the winter, more nuts become available and rooted vegetables. And it's just nature tells us, you know, it really does. And then traditional diet, what's your ethnicity? I'm mostly Italian. I like Mediterranean food, you know, and once in a while an Asian dish or something. And so, but, you know, but everyone has preferences based on their culture or their religion. Or, you know, some people are vegetarian based on, you know, religious belief. And you have to work with that. You don't fight with it. You know, nutrient deficiencies. You have to, if someone is nutrient deficient, you try to shift the diet to provide high amounts of that nutrient so that they bathe their body. You can supplement as well, but sometimes you can do it through the diet. And then the microenvironment, you know, what does the blood test tell us and how do we make adjustments based on that? And you'll see more on all of these now. So some basic rules. This was the first meal I had when I got to Israel, by the way, and that's what I call healthy eating right there. That was at a restaurant, right, Tel Aviv on the water, when I was there a couple years ago. and a little local place, and that was perfect meal, just perfectly balanced. So again, healthy relationships, start with your spirit, connect the intellect, the emotion, consider all aspects of diet from culture, taste, smell, color, texture, the source, but always eat fresh and wholesome from the earth, prepared with love and intent to nourish. And if you just take that line, wholesome, from the earth, prepared with love and intent to nourish, you would never walk in a fast food place again the rest of your life. You're not even interested in that, you know. You might grow a garden. You might start, you know, picking your basil leaf every day. You know, I water our little plants out on our porch, and every one I go through the thyme and the sage and the basil, and I'm always smelling those smells, and they're so wonderful, and they're so, you know, lifting. And then, you know, smelling something in a, you know, again, in a fast food joint, it's like, oh gosh, I can't even go near there. It's like, why is that appealing to people? What is it that's missing? That something like this isn't incredibly appealing? On every level, the color, the way it looks, the taste, the smell, and then the nourishment you get from it. So study, half of all cancer deaths, this is a brand new study, May 19th, 2016. Brand new study in the JAMA Oncology, major medical journal. And this is what it states. Half of all cancer deaths, 20 to 40% of cancer cases in the USA could potentially be prevented if individuals adopted a healthier lifestyle, according to this recent study. Do you believe that? Half, you know, of all cancer deaths are preventable. And that's from the latest data from JAMA, where they did, again, a pooled analysis of research. And then another study found that the overall health may be the key to beating breast and other cancers. So everyone wants to focus on the cancer, but here they're telling you, why don't we just focus on the patient? And often that's even more important than focusing on the cancer. So women with the poorest physical health score had a 27% increased risk of experiencing either a reoccurrence of their breast cancer or a new breast cancer, and a 65% increased risk of death from any cause. So the healthier your overall health is, the better off you are. And so that's what we try to do. We try to create, so people say, well, gosh, it's a lot of, you know, often a lot of herbs, a lot of nutrients, but I'm saying I'm looking at you from every angle to make you as healthy as possible, not just focusing on this one little thing. Because in the end, I'm proud of the fact that I have so many cancer patients that are now 20, 25 years with me because this is what I've done and still living well. So I have this really beautiful relationship. So organic food, these are some of the reasons why having a higher, have significant fewer pesticides, lower level of total pesticides, have significantly increased level of redox antioxidant compounds, which are typically secondary compounds, not the main ones, contain greater concentrations of total nutrition, particularly phytonutrients, and they enhance organic production, enhances milk nutritional quality by shifting fatty acid composition. So in other words, grass-fed, you know, animals like cows that eat from the ground and not are force-fed commercial grain yield higher levels of an important compound called CLA, conjugated linoleic acid, which is basically not found in commercial milk. CLA is actually shown to have weight-reducing properties as well as cancer-inhibiting properties too. And my personal favorite is wild. So better than organic food is wild food. So non-hybrided wild food is the best. And we'll talk about a few of those. And then people say, do I always have to eat everything organic? Well, here's a really good list. And I can make this available to everyone. It could be PDF'd and sent to Dr. Ross. And if people want it, maybe he can distribute it through an email to you if you want it, because I know you're not going to be able to write everything down. But if you want it, just let us know. And so these are the foods, and this is the newest list of all. These are the foods that you want to definitely eat organic: apples, celery, strawberries, and then these are what's called the clean 15. So you know, it's still better to eat organic, but they're far less sprayed and have far less herbicides and pesticides. And then as far as fish goes, these are the best fish to eat: salmon, sardines. I'm a big proponent of sardines, mussels, trout, mackerel, and then these are okay, and those are less favorable. And then I always tell people to eat for color, and so make sure you have a lot of color in your plate. And these are some of the phytonutrients or phytochemicals associated with those colors that we really want to have, and then the foods that they are found in. So, you know, you can pick red, purple are really rich in anthocyanins, which are a group of polyphenola compounds, really associated with slowing down aging process in the body, promoting healthier eye health, healthier liver health, healthier brain health, protection against chronic disease, help reduce inflammatory processes and oxidative processes. And berries are a great source, grapes, red wine, prunes, but another really good source are the heirloom small purple potatoes too. Those are loaded with what makes them purple are all the anthocyanins. So now let's look at that human being, that branch one or that host, that constitution, you know, energetic influence, the inward anabolic recuperative energy, again, and then the outward catabolic energy. So the outward energy is associated with male energy or masculine energy. It's strong, it's rigid. The inward energy, which is more feminine, is more restorative and associated more with moisture and flexibility. And that is always inward energy trumps outward energy. So feminine energy is stronger than masculine energy when we're looking at longevity. Flexibility is often more important than rigidity. You know, when they used to build buildings, big tall buildings, they made them as strong as possible, and they found out that they, you know, that wasn't effective. When they learned to build some flex, like in the Empire State Building, actually when the wind comes, it actually moves slightly, and that helps keep it, you know, a healthier building and sustains it. So we want both flexibility, nourishment inward and outward. And most people with cancer, most people aging actually need support in both areas. That's what I found, that it's not one or the other. Sometimes you just need both. And then the three energies we look like, the vital force is really a look at the efficiency of digestive energy, lung energy to create energy. The essence is the endocrine health, all of the hormones in your endocrine system, not just a single hormone as a whole, is referred to as the energy of the essence. And then the vital spirit is this connection, the spiritual energy within and throughout us, which is the everlasting energy. You never ever lose vital spirit. It's the only energy that the older you get can actually keep growing. Everything else, no matter what, you know, is going to dissipate at some point. And then how we nourish our body. So we need three types of nourishment: celestial, which is breathing, oxygenating our tissues and our cells of our body; earthly, which is feeding good healthy food and drinking good water; and then spiritual energy, which one of my favorite people is John Wooden, who is a great, you know, maybe the greatest basketball coach of ever from UCLA. He wrote many wonderful books, and one of his many great sayings was, you can't live a perfect day without doing something for someone who can never repay you back. That was one of his famous quotes. And he says, you really don't learn anything in life until after you know it all. Yeah. And so here's just all the ways that you assess the constitution of the host. What's the hair like? Is it dry? Is it falling out? Is it healthy? What are the nails like? This tells us a lot about the essence. The nails, the teeth can tell you a lot about how healthy your bones are. You do a DEXA scan and it tells you the density of your bones, but not the health of your bones. So your nails and your teeth can reflect that, and even your hair, your skin, the eyes, the gums, the teeth. We try to observe all of those things. They all give us a deeper insight into the health. The ears, a lot about the kidneys. The ears correlate to the kidneys. The eyes correlate to the liver. And so a lot of, you know, conventional doctors say, what do the eyes have to do with the liver? And I say, where's the first place you see jaundice? In the eyes, you know, and that's a disease of the liver. So many, many other ways you can see into the eyes factors there. Pulse, temperature. Someone loves cold weather. They're always hot. Another person's always cold. You know, blood pressure. You know, body type. Where your weight's distributed, not just you know that you have extra weight. Digestive system, metabolism. and then stressors. All of this is taken into account. And then I apply thinking. I mean, I've developed sort of the energetic way that I think is really a combination of the Eastern traditional Chinese medicine or East Asian system of medicine combined with the American eclectic medical tradition and a little bit that what's called the physiomedical tradition as well. In America, 100 years ago, we had a group of physicians called the eclectics and another group called the physiomedicalist. And I'm a scholar of the eclectic medical school. And my favorite doctor was a man named Eli Jones of all of them. But there was Scudder, Ellingwood, Felter. There were many, many people. And they were not only wonderful physicians, but they were even graduating women from medical school in the mid-1800s. And they were very politically active in a very positive way. And really, the common denominator of all traditional medical systems was first, rather, the first objective is to cooperate and strengthen the internal life force of the patient. That's always the first thing to do. And then to try to understand what symptoms are reflective of disease and what symptoms are reflective of the body's response to disease, which you don't necessarily want to repress all the time. Fever is a great example. You get an infection, you get a fever go up, we all of a sudden want to lower the temperature. And of course, extremely high fevers not treated properly with diuretics and different things we would do can be problematic, but you go from one extreme to saying, let's just lower the temperature with not knowing that temperature is the first phase of immune response to basically kill off the pathogen directly and then signal other aspects of the immune system. So here you have it again, expend energy, catabolic, restore energy, anabolic. Today we're out here, I'm out here talking, I'm catabolic. I'm breaking down my energy in order to give out. You know, I go to sleep at night, I nourish my body goes into a restoration anabolic phase. And as we get older, we're all getting more and more catabolic and less anabolic. So that's why you see someone, you know, normally to age 75, what people have, you know, are mostly having issues around weight gain. But if you notice, when you start hitting your 80s and 90s, all of a sudden it's the opposite. Now people can't keep weight on. They're actually becoming very, very cachexic at that stage. They're losing everything, muscle mass, fat. And so, you know, muscle mass is a very precious, particularly when you're older. About 35-40% of cancer patients actually die of wasting syndrome, actually can't maintain it. So a big part, again, of foundational is how to just do some basic things to maintain that or reduce the alterations in age-related decline related to catabolic processes. And so here we have it. Not all everything about catabolic is bad. Again, when we take our food in, a healthy catabolic pathway is creating good energy from the food we eat. You know, how well when you eat your food, or is it turning into energy real efficiently? That is a healthy catabolic process. The anabolic process is when you take the food you eat, what molecules in that food are building the cells of our body? Whether they be heart cells, eye cells, muscle cells, immune cells, whatever it is, that's the anabolic process. And so again, we're trying to create good efficiency in this process. Now, looking again, basically at that endocrine essence energy. And so here we have the kidney, the kidney network, which the kidney is mostly in energetic terms, a look at the hub of the endocrine system, which is the HPA axis or the neuroendocrine system, the hypothalamus, pituitary, and adrenal glands. And a lot of people emphasize the adrenal glands, but really the adrenals are networked very intimately with the brain center, the hypothalamus, which usually, if you can imagine your hypothalamus having an antenna that sticks out of your brain, as well as an antenna that goes in your brain, trying to decipher the most important way that energy should be transferred in the body. And then it communicates with the pituitary, the adrenal gland, and then that hub is then connected to all of the other endocrine glands, as well as networked to the nervous system. And so when people need nourishment for the kidney endocrine system, you know, these are some of the foods, you know, that we like to do. Sesame seeds, black and white, black or even, you know, better, black beans, yams, sweet potatoes, seaweed, cruciferous vegetables, particularly if there's like overactive thyroid. You know, thyroid is part of the endocrine system. Say somebody has hyperthyroidism, overactive thyroid. We usually have them in their diet drink cabbage juice, 4 to 8 ounces of cabbage juice, and use 3 or 4 different herbs in a formulation, mostly leonoris, which is motherwort, and lycopis, which is bugleweed, and sometimes an herb called Gromswell, sometimes Melissa, and we usually give a teaspoonful 3 times a day with the cabbage juice, and lo and behold, their hyperthyroidism slowly goes back to normal. And the cabbage juice is very, very good for that. And the seaweed is usually supportive to the thyroid. It's a natural source of iodine, but it's also rich in all kinds of other minerals and alginates, which are chelate toxins in the body. It's very alkalizing seaweed, loaded with carotenoids. An interesting carotenoid called fucoxanthin is in seaweed, which basically turns brown fat white fat, you know, what's called WAT, white adipose tissue, into BAT, which is brown adipose tissue. So you have two kinds of fat in your body, white and brown. Brown is efficiently burned as energy, so it's part of how we make energy. White, the job of white is two things: preserve the body for famine or insulate the body. And it's very stingy. Your body doesn't want to release that white fat. But there's a few things in your diet you can eat to accelerate that. The best thing is seaweed salad made from wakame. So if you've ever been to a Japanese restaurant and ever ate the seaweed salad, one of the best things that you could eat for burning that WAT off your body. So then we have foods that nourish the liver energy. They're mostly bitter and cooling. And then foods that move the liver energy: dandelion greens, arugula, artichokes, beets, radishes, sour cherries, cucumbers, watermelons. These are all good. And cucumbers particularly cool excess heat in a hot summer day. If the liver gets too fiery, it's very unhealthy. And so the cucumbers are very good. And one of my favorite things to do is have people juice, you know, have a juicer and juice the whole watermelon, the rind, seed, and everything. That's so good for you. And put some cucumber in with it as well. It's really delicious. It cools the temperature. If you're like overheated and been out on a hot summer day, and you just drink that nice cool juice, and you just feel so cool afterwards. And then foods that also nourish the spleen tend to be dry and sweet and warming. They can be grains like quinoa and barley. Putting more aromatic herbs in your food to warm the spleen up. A lot of people have what we call dampness in the spleen, which really stagnates the stomach, because the first aspect of digestion is heat. First thing your body has to do is heat the stomach up, and a lot of people get gaseous and get bloated, partially because they can't generate the energy to heat their stomach up to digest. So we can help that by using aromatic herbs, warming your food up, not having it be too cold, and add things, you know, many things: pepper, mustard, cinnamon. Dr. Ross's place has this little powder blend now of turmeric, ginger, and cinnamon that I think they use in the smoothie and in teas, and that blend is, again, that warms the spleen, warms the digestion up a little bit, amongst other things. It does a lot of other things. Citrus peel too, orange peel, tangerine peel also aid in the digestion in that way. And my favorite is cardamom, which I would actually add to that little powder, maybe just a tiny bit of cardamom to that little powder, because that's just so good for warming the digestion up. And I like to use things like that in the smoothie, because the smoothie is a little cold and a little damp, and so for people that don't have that, when you add those spices to the colder foods, it really helps them be digested a lot better. So another thing is, a lot of people are blood deficient, particularly on chemotherapy, which is very destructive to the bone marrow. So then we want to change the diet to nourish their blood. And so, in a general way, beets are very good for the blood, and they're very good for the liver as well. And they have a lot of nutrients. Betaine is the one that's most associated with being potentially cancer suppressing. Cherries are an old remedy that support the blood and also detoxify uric acid. You can buy sour cherries and eat them as a snack, or you can use black cherry concentrate and make a little spritzer with it with some seltzer water, and put a little bit of lohan or stevia or honey if you want to have a little sweet little natural soda. My favorite of all is blackstrap molasses. I consider that an incredible medicinal food, loaded. You know how many natural iron and minerals and phytonutrients, and particular, there's 600 milligrams of potassium in 1 tablespoon of blackstrap molasses. And that can go in, even a little bit can go in some savory dishes too. We put it a lot of times in our what's called immune enhancing bone marrow soup, just a little bit of molasses in there. Again, just to restore, being even better blood builder. And so that's the final thing, the immune building bone marrow soup, which you use mostly animal bones. Of course, I don't eat meat, so I wouldn't be drinking that myself, but it's still really nourishing and really important for people with cancer to consume. And we load it with both crude herbs. We have an herb blend that we use in our clinic, mostly Chinese herbs, but some herbs like yellow dock, rumex, that we also add in it, that you cook the herbs in the soup with all of the bones and the vegetables. And then you start adding some powdered herbs at the end and some miso at the end. A lot of aromatic herbs could be cilantro and parsley. And basically I have want all of my patients that are on chemo to be drinking about a bowl a day of that soup if they can. So again, I went through, these are the foods that support and nourish the spleen energy. And you can see all of these too, like Napa cabbage and sugar snap peas, sweet potatoes, yams, a lot of fish, steamed fish in particular is really good for that. Caraway seeds, I forgot to mention them too, anise seeds, coriander seeds, grains and beans such as barley and millet and oats and rice, black and white beans, chickpeas, fava beans, figs. And then a great one is fermented food, you know, your probiotic foods as well. Sauerkraut, kimchi, things like that are really, really good for that. So here's a whole thing on fermented foods, and a study on young Polish women who ate sauerkraut 3 or more times a week had 60% reduction in breast cancer reoccurrence. In India, they eat a drink called lassi with meals, which is mostly a kind of a yogurt, like kefir drink, and they make it with rose water or with mango in it, and that's commonly eaten in India. And there's so much immune support with fermented foods. And factors affecting intestinal, what's called the intestinal microecosystem. Again, we see this under kind of that spleen energy, but we can go out and now just look at. So antibiotics, microbial infections, diet high in processed food, low in fiber foods, chronic diarrhea, stress really alters the microbiome, the ecosystem. Chlorinated water, radiation and chemotherapy, and colonic therapy. And this is a kind of a very complex little schematic here of all the importance of probiotics, all of the wonderful things that they do, immune modulation, normalizing that microbiome. And I don't give people probiotic supplements unless I feel that they have had an issue and we need to restore it. So I'll do it for a little while, but I rarely sustain people on them. I like people, once they establish a good flora, to basically be getting it through their prebiotics and probiotics. So that's how I feel. But probiotics have been shown to help so many issues, even autoimmune disease now. It's a great deal of research on probiotics, not with just Crohn's disease, but also even with rheumatoid arthritis, acne, so many different rosacea, so many different conditions. So prebiotics is another really, prebiotics basically increase beneficial bifidobacteria in the gut, and they encourage an environment conducive for the probiotics to proliferate in. So we like to have a lot of foods that have prebiotics in them. One is the sunchokes, the Jerusalem artichokes, globe artichokes as well, chicory, eggplant, asparagus, oats. And sometimes we use a little FOS or inulin powder as well, which you can purchase. But here I did a blog on the Jerusalem artichoke, which is a northeastern American food. It's native, you know, it's from the native Indians ate it. It can be grated and added to salad. Lends itself to purees and soups very nicely. And then you can dry roast it in an oven up to 4 or 5 hours, and you get this really nice crunchy outside. It crunches and the inside is still nice and soft. So 2 minutes, we're taking a break. Well, actually, I should go 5 minutes over because we start a little bit over. So let's make it 7 minutes. Actually, I have a clock here, Jenny. So I have, according to my clock, I have 9 minutes. So major foods for the Liver Detoxification Network. So here we have, again, bitter foods that are cooling tend to be really good for the liver. But now you can go into all your cruciferous vegetables as well. Broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cauliflower, cabbage, and generally speaking, these foods should be cooked. They have a lot of, they have goitrogens in them, so people that don't have hyperthyroidism, you know, it would not be the healthiest thing for them to eat, because goitrogens are thyroid suppressing. Certainly a little bit is no problem. This would take quite a large consumption. Like I said, the cabbage juice is for sure a way to lower your thyroid activity. But the other thing is that the availability of phytonutrients in some of these foods, particularly the indoles and what's called isothiocyanates, these compounds become more bioavailable when they're cooked, particularly cooked with a little bit of oil, say olive oil, and then steamed, or steamed and then put the oil over the top of them after that. So bitter leafy salad greens, fruits like prunes, raisins, blueberries, blackberries, strawberries, oranges, also citrus fruit tends to be good. And the citrus rind is really, peel, not the rind, is really, really good for the gallbladder and liver. It's particularly good for cleansing the gallbladder of gallstones. Pears, actually, if someone's having a gallbladder pain, drinking fresh pear juice eliminates the pain immediately. Pears are very good for the gallbladder. They're moistening, and they're really good for the lungs as well. So in the fall, a great thing to do with pears is to stew them. You just poach them, and you put a little cinnamon in there, a little ginger in there, a little bit of honey, and even a little bit of orange peel. And you just stew them for a little while, and you can either make it into a sauce, or you can just let them stew shortly, and then eat it as a dessert almost. Really, really yummy. And fresh squeezed lemon juice and apple cider vinegar and hot water also kind of purges a little bit the liver and gallbladder. So here's pears and pear juice, which I just said, with lemon and ginger. These are all great foods for the gallbladder. And cucumbers, like I said, are very cooling and a great juice with watermelon, particularly in the summertime. It's not something you would do in the winter. And then avoid overcooked foods, blackened foods. They all increase lipid peroxidation. Meat is also very, very hard. Greasy food, fried foods, all of those. Minimize alcohol and stay hydrated. Very, very important to stay hydrated. And some of my favorites is dandelion greens right here, one of the most nutrient foods in the entire world. So much great research on dandelion greens for health. They've even shown in animals, they showed feeding dandelions to mice really increased their swimming time, so it actually had an effect on increasing energy performance. But all these nutrients in dandelions. And you can blanch them, and that takes some of the bitterness out, and then saute them afterwards, like you do broccoli au rabe. I don't know if you ever made Italian broccoli, but you do the dandelion greens kind of the same way. And it's very, very good. And probably my ultimate favorite salad is an arugula tricolor salad, arugula with endive and radicchio, with a simple balsamic mustard, olive oil, garlic dressing on it. So arugula is extremely healthy as well. A nutrient-dense food, that's what you want, nutrient-dense foods. And arugula is kind of wild. It grows really easy. You just throw it in the ground, like the sunchokes too, those Jerusalem artichokes. You plant it and it's like potatoes. It just goes crazy everywhere under the ground. And they're very humble food. Another great food is the mamortica, the bitter melon, which you can get a lot of times in Asian markets. Best food for as an insulin sensitizer. It's referred to as vegetable insulin. So anyone with insulin resistance, anyone with diabetes, this is probably the best food you can consume. It's used all throughout the tropics, all throughout Asia, all the island people, everybody knows it as a medicinal food. And it can be juiced as well. It's bitter, but you can cut it with other juices to cut into that bitterness. That's the beauty. And it has also exhibited, more recently, a lot of cancer-suppressing compounds too. And it enhances the uptake of glucose, promotes insulin release, activates AMPK, potentiates its effects, makes it more efficient as well. And there's how you cook it. And then here's just a little bit of the research on it for cancer inhibition. Significantly reduced head and neck squamous cell growth in mice by targeting c-MET, c-MYC, STAT3, and MCL1 signaling. So you can see here, IV extract of Mimortica to nude mice resulted in 100% survival compared to 80. Inhibited breast cancer. So a really, really great food to have. And then artichokes. Artichokes, avocados, asparagus, cilantro, all are great foods for increasing the most important redox antioxidant in our cells called glutathione. These are all foods. Glutathione is a major way that our cells detoxify toxins and equalize oxidative stress. And these foods spare it. There's three amino acids that build glutathione, so they're actually built from protein, but these foods encourage it and spare its degradation as well. The three amino acids are cysteine, glutamine, and glycine. Cysteine, glutamine, and glycine all together create glutathione in the body. And here's asparagus, all the great compounds. And asparagus is particularly good for the lymphatic system. So it's cleansing to the lymph system. Really rich in the vitamin K, A, B vitamins, iron, selenium, carotenoids, and inulin as well. So it's a good prebiotic. Contains the phenolic compounds, quercetin, camphorol, and also, like I said, rich in glutathione. Has some other interesting compounds like aspargeric acid, which kind of gives that odor to it, and then also contains lipoic acid, which is probably the most important nutrient when it comes to redox control in the cells, and it's also very important for insulin and glucose utilization. The richest source of lipoic acid, however, is potatoes. Potatoes have the most lipoic acid. So kidneys are also very detoxifying to the, asparagus, very detoxifying to the kidneys and to the lungs.
Excuse me.
Yes.
About three slides back, you mentioned an extract. What was the name of it? I missed it. Oh, yes. Excuse me.
That's all right. Okay, one more minute and we're taking a break. Here's a little recipe I have a lot of patients make, what's also called an asparagus puree, where you cook up the asparagus almost like a soup and you puree it. Actually, you can make a soup and you just consume a couple of ounces of that every day. And again, very, very cleansing, very detoxifying, very soothing. Asparagus also is a little bit mucilaginous, so it is very soothing to the kidneys particularly. And then here's another little recipe, ginger sesame asparagus salad. And then this will be our last slide, and then we'll pick up on the lungs. Vinegar aids in cancer suppression as well. And it's a great for metabolizing and having insulin trophic effects. So one of the best things you can do, simple things you can do for your digestion that has all kinds of health benefits, is taking apple cider vinegar, a teaspoon to a tablespoon in warm water, and just drinking that, sipping that with your meals. Tastes a little bit like a cider, almost like an apple cider. And it also encourages enzyme release in the body without being overly acidic. So if people think they need a little bit more hydrochloric acid, they can just use apple cider vinegar, and it's a much better way to go because there's all kinds of benefits. And you can use other vinegars as well. It doesn't have to be apple cider vinegar. All vinegars have health benefits. They all regulate insulin, blood sugar levels. They also improve calcium absorption and uptake by the bone. They prevent displaced calcifications in the body. You know, so much about age-related disease is issues around calcifications. You know, you have breast calcifications, bone spurs, calcified arthritis, calcified arteries. So we're always looking about ways to get nutrients and minerals where they're supposed to be, not where they're not supposed to be. So vinegar can really aid in that uptake. We are going to move on to diet for the lung and oxygen network. Again, the lungs are responsible for oxygenating the body. And so the more efficient, it's not that we want to put oxygen in the body, we want to breathe better and oxygenate our cells better. We want to figure out ways to do that. That's very, very, very important. So foods can actually help with the lung health. I mentioned pears cooked with honey, which are very moistening. In the wintertime, you have to think in terms of keeping the lungs moist. They don't like to be dried out. And then mushrooms are also very good for the lungs. But one of the best foods, again, available in Asian markets is called lotus root. And pretty much every Asian market will have lotus root there. And you slice it, and it looks kind of like silver dollars, and it's got little hollow cutout parts in it. It's very, very good for the lungs. And generally, fresh greens, soups, and purees, warm soups are also really good for the lungs. Rooted vegetables, garlic, and onions are all wonderful. And then foods rich in chlorophyll and foods rich in carotenoids. And carotenoids help oxygenate the cells as well, particularly what's called the aqueous carotenoids rather than the fat-soluble carotenoids. One of the best spices for the lungs is a spice called saffron. You might know it. You've heard of saffron rice, or people use saffron. Last night I had mussels in saffron. But saffron is an amazing spice and herb that has a carotenoid called crocetin, which oxygenates the cells. Saffron also elevates the mood and is neuroprotective. And carotenoids are like lutein, lycopene, beta, alpha carotene, xanthin, they are associated with a reduction of several forms of cancer and heart disease as well. So high carotenoid intake reduced signs of lung aging by 1 to 2 years. Another study found 6 major serum carotenoids studied correlated were associated with better lung function in the elderly. And then here, legumes, grains, and seeds are also good sources of carotenoids. What makes sweet potatoes and yams that orange color are the carotenoids. They're also high in egg yolks. They found that egg yolks, or the lutein in the egg yolk, was better than taking supplements or any other form. So the egg yolk is a very good food for eye health. And you can put an egg yolk, not the white, but the egg yolk can go into the smoothie as well. It's a good little added booster. It's rich in phospholipids, sphingolipids, choline, inositol, iron. It's one of the richest sources of vitamin B5, pantothenic acid. I mean, it has a lot of nutrients in it. And what makes the egg yolk, particularly, again, if the chickens are running around, what makes it so orange is all the carotenoids in there. Persimmons are also really good for the lungs. And they moisten the lungs. And they're really high in carotenoids. Paprika is very high in those aqueous carotenoids. And fistin, a flavonoid present in strawberries and persimmons, also is shown to inhibit colon, breast, and prostate cancer. And then here, orange-colored fruits and vegetables, winter squashes, mangoes, apricots, carrots are all rich in those compounds. And edible flowers, too, are really good. I don't know if you ever had nasturtiums, like in a salad. They're little spicy yellow flowers, really high in carotenoids. And zucchini flowers are really good, too. Italians like to eat the zucchini flowers. And here are carotenoids, mechanisms by which they're known to suppress cancer, all different mechanisms. So carotenoids, phenolic compounds, and the sulfur compounds like the isothiocyanates are some of the most important compounds. And wild salmon has a carotenoid called astaxanthin, also with great, great health benefits. And there, when they farm raise the fish, they have to inject them with dye to make them look like they're orange, because they don't get to eat the foods that give them, particularly the eggs that give them that nice orange color. So now we're going to move into nutrigenomics and nutra epi genomics. So the nutrigenomics provide an opportunity to study gene expression is regulated by nutrients and how nutrients affect gene variations and epigenetic expression. So basically, it's the relationship of food and our genes together, bathing together, what kind of relationship they have. And then there's nutri-epigenetics, focuses on the influence of certain dietary agents in our food and spices and herbs on epigenetic mechanisms. And so here you can see epigenetics and then nutrigenetics, and you can see the relationship again on the molecular relationship between nutrients and response of genes, and then the interaction of various genes and genotypes in the foods that we eat. In other words, somebody might say caffeine is bad for bone health. They found that, you know, having a lot of caffeine induced osteoporosis, but then when they did a further analysis of the data, it was only certain genotypes that really were affected. Other people had no effect, no impact on. And this becomes very important in cancer as well. A big popular gene that's studied is very, very popular now is the called MTHFR, methylene tetrahydrofolinic acid pathway. And basically people that don't convert folate and other nutrients and have good what's called methylation processes in the body. And methylation is very important to gene transcription amongst other things. Poor methylation also puts you at higher risk for various cancers, heart disease, neurological disease, eye diseases, gout. I mean, there's just so many issues related to that. And so what we're finding is that some people have defects in being able to take those nutrients and efficiently methylate with them. So sometimes they need support. We found also recently that the better your microbiome is, the better you methylate as well. So again, eating well, encouraging good gut health helps you methylate. Getting good organic sources of those B vitamins and some of the other betaine, which I talked about, is very, very important too. Helps with methylation. So lots of green foods, lots of orange foods are very, very useful for that. And then what we were talking about is people have what's called these SNPs or polymorphisms, single nucleotide polymorphisms. And sometimes you're heterozygous, which means that one of your parents gave you this defect gene, and sometimes you're homozygous, which means both parents together. Now you have two bad copies of that gene, and that's not, you know, considered so great. But I feel like we all learn to compensate. Our bodies are so amazing, so that even when we're given sometimes not perfect genes from our parents, often our bodies, if fed right and treated right, can learn to adapt and compensate and deal with it. It's like, you know, you lose your eyesight, and what happens? Your hearing gets a lot better. So I don't get too worried again if we just do what we can to optimize our health. And they also found, here's a study that shows combination of dietary compounds equates to much better health than eating any one of those things. So here is wine, you know, with all of the data, computing all the data on drinking wine, 150 mils a day, 32% reduction in cardiovascular disease. And then fish, 14%, dark chocolate, 21%. And then dark chocolate intake recently shown to buffer stress reactivity in humans. So there's even a stress protective effect from eating dark chocolate. Fruits and vegetables, garlic, almonds. But then when they combined all these factors, they believe that the risk of cardiovascular disease decreased as much as 76% by combining all of these factors, these dietary factors. Now, important dietary consideration for the cancer patient. And we'll get into specifics. What you need to keep in mind, again, is, first of all, the conventional therapies that somebody's doing. Somebody undergoing surgery to recover needs a lot of anabolic restoration, much more protein. Nutrient demands, like for zinc and glutamine, significantly go up 5-10-fold to recover better. So then you have radiation, very destructive to the body, needs lots of cooling factors, mucilaginous foods, and again, anabolic restoration foods, and hydration. Hydration is so key. Enhanced recovery, anabolic. A whole class of studying food and nutrients in oncology, particularly around surgery, is actually now called immunonutrition. It's a whole class of a study and lots of data on of nutrients that aid in recovery, basically, from conventional therapies, mostly surgery, radiation. Immune-enhancing bone marrow soup, protect against side effects, detoxify as well. And then look at the microenvironment. If there's inflammation, systemic inflammation, your diet can alter inflammation. You can also eat foods that resist thrombosis, lower thrombotic markers, and then deal with insulin resistance. You know, you look at somebody's hemoglobin A1C, their fasting insulin, their C-peptide, and other biomarkers. You can now assess whether there or also what's called leptin resistance, which is another adipose hormone that's also associated with cancer initiation, cancer growth, and cancer invasion. And so all of these things could be assessed. Sometimes it's obvious when you see people, but other times you want to see the blood markers and then alter the diet, put in some of the nutrients, and 3-4 months later, check it again, and then show you, look at how much better you're doing. Look at what you've just done to your body by embracing this. Nutrient deficiencies like vitamin D, iron, zinc, selenium, and tumor molecular phenotyping, like what's your tumor about, you can cater your diet to all of this information. And now here's on caloric restriction improves chemo response and reduces toxicity. Basically, if you eat less before you have chemotherapy, a day before, your chemotherapy gets more sensitized to the cancer cells and becomes less adversary to the healthy cells because your healthy cells go into resting phase. Because when you're not getting enough calories, your metabolism actually slows down. But cancer cells' metabolism never slows down. It goes 24/7 no matter what goes on. You can stop eating, the metabolism's still going. You can sleep at night. When we all get into a resting phase, do you think cancer rests? No, it just keeps going. And so we will rest the healthy cells this way and improve that. And again, you have to do everything personalized. If someone's very weak and has a lot of deficiencies, you've got to really keep feeding them the best you can, prepare them. They have to stay strong. I still think that's a priority. But you have to, if you can, I like to do more just the smoothie and the soup about 24 hours a day of the chemo and for the next day afterwards, and then start to get back to, you know, pretty well-balanced diet. And we have all of our patients basically take the combination of one of our Power Adapt mostly, or Vital Adapt, mixed with a tea that we create called Shazam, which is about 7 or 8 herbs that we put together. And then you make an iced tea from the Shazam, mix 50-50 Shazam and coconut water, and then put a teaspoon of Power Adapt in it, like in a 12-16 ounce bottle. And around chemotherapy infusion, you're drinking that the whole time. And that's a very common thing we have our patients do. And you can see coconut water is a delicious beverage, clear, sweet, hot, rich in electrolytes, and much more effective at hydrating than water is. A lot of people, you can drink all the water you want and you're still not hydrating very often. Coconut water is a very good way to hydrate. Soup broths are a very good way to hydrate too. Little broth with a little miso in it, very, very good. Because some people actually need to have a little bit of sodium to help the water be retained in the tissue as well. And then here is the herbal infusion. And again, you can all have this and you can see what we do. We blend that in the clinic as one tea, so you're not trying to buy all those herbs yourself, or Dr. Ross's clinic can probably make something similar up just like this for you. Endocrine disruptors. Now let's look at the factors with the environment we live in and why we're, you know, often so toxic, you know. All of these substances that are in our food, in our water, and in our air, in our house, in our homes, in our work environment, put our bodies under tremendous stress. And some of them, one of the leading causes of obesity, bisphenol A, they found children, you know, obese children had very high levels of urine output of bisphenol A. There was a strong correlation between that. So again, what we do is we try to clean the environment up as best we can, but we also put in our diet and in our supplement program, things that aid in the detoxification, cellular detoxification of these endocrine disruptors. And, you know, they keep telling us that everything is safe, but here's what they said in 1947 about DDT. This is DDT. These are advertisements for DDT in the 40s and the 50s. Planes flying over, spraying people, shooting children with it in pools, you know, swallowing it. And now we have, you know, GMO, genetically modified organisms in most of our food supply, and we're all getting, and that's all giving us not only, you know, altered organisms, but also high levels of Roundup. Roundup is a terrible endocrine disruptor. They found that one of the areas that Roundup really goes after is the aromatase pathway. It stimulates aromatase activity. So again, aromatase is activated in many age-related diseases, most notably cancer. And the major drug used to treat breast cancer now are aromatase inhibitors. But why are we all aromatizing so much? Why, when we reach midlife or go through menopause or men later on in life, why are all the androgen hormones going down and all this kind of artificial estrogen, not healthy estrogen, are we getting loaded with? It's a lot of it is the environment that mimics all these chemicals in our body mimic estrogen. They're called xenoestrogens or endocrine disruptors. And they wreak havoc. They occupy the receptors so the healthier hormones can't get there. In the thyroid, you have things like chlorine and bromine that look like iodine, so they get to the receptors, they gum it up. And so we do have to try to clean our diet up and take things to help our bodies excrete these things and get rid of them to restore a better endocrine state of health. So cruciferous vegetables are one of the best ways to detoxify endocrine disruptors. You know, they upregulate detoxification pathways, repair genes, and they even can induce apoptosis in cells that are past being repaired. They activate tumor suppressor genes and selectively upregulate reactive oxygen species. They basically, this new pathway of detoxification that's the central detoxifier is called NRF2. And NRF2 detoxifies endocrine disruptors. And one of the big compounds is called isothiocyanates, which the best source of one of them, called sulforaphane, is the sprout of broccoli. So broccoli sprouts are one of the best foods you can eat. Strongly associated with cancer suppression. They regulate, remember if we go back to that theory of aging, they regulate the histones, downregulate cancer cell by being a histone deacetylase inhibitor, sulforaphane. Another natural histone regulator is called butyric acid, and the richest source of butyric acid is Parmesan cheese, actually. You know, Reggiano Parmesan cheese is really rich in butyric acid. Butter actually has butyric acid, and that also is a natural down regulator of histone deacetylase in cancer cells. So here is the mechanisms. This is another compound. So this PEIT is the phenyl ester isothiocyanate found in cabbage and cabbage sprouts. So again, going back to the health benefits of cabbage, which is a very humble food, very, very rich in this compound. And look of it, it's chemo preventative effects there. And what they learn about these isothiocyanates as well as phenolic compounds is that they are selective in what they do. They're not actually what we call antioxidants. They actually are shown to be protective to the healthy cell, but actually encourage oxidation in the cancer cell. So we call them redox cyclers. And they know the difference between the cancer cell and the healthy cell. There's lots and lots of data on this. So that whole theory of don't take things, you know, antioxidants, because you might inhibit cancer, the chemotherapy, is just theoretical hogwash. It really, really is. These compounds are redox between oxidation and antioxidation. But I think we caused a big problem by coining some of these, using some of these words, because antioxidation is not a good word for anything in nature, because things don't tend to be anti. They don't tend to be so, they tend to be modulatory and not anti, you know, or antibiotic is for a drug, but a plant really isn't an antibiotic. I mean, there may be circumstances where they can exhibit an antibiotic-like effect, But it's such a simplification of how you think of a whole herb working in the body, immunologically speaking. And so I think the language that have been adopted for drugs is not the right language for natural medicine. It gets us in more trouble than what we know. So here is the difference of sulforaphane content from whole broccoli. How much whole broccoli it takes compared to 3 days of a sprout, and then what happens in a capsule. And we have a formula, Cell Guardian, which has a lot of sulforaphane in it, as well as the cabbage sprouts, as well as another great source of isothiocyanates called wasabi or horseradish. There's 27 different isothiocyanates in wasabi. And wasabi is thermogenic. So going back, why are the Japanese people so thin? They're eating seaweed, they're eating hot mustard, ginger, pickled ginger. Wasabi, these all things are thermogenic. They basically keep your metabolism really, really active. And here's the immune enhancing soup. The bones we most recommend are lamb bones. Lamb is a meat that tends to be, lambs are animals that they can't handle a lot of antibiotics and a lot of growth hormones. They're raised pretty cleanly, and so typically, and in Chinese medicine, lamb stew is considered a medicine. And so lamb is one of the best bones to use to make it. And then we add these fujian herbs like astragalus, dongguei, rumex, and you cook those in this soup. And then our powdered herbs, often towards the end, and the soup is at the end, just simmering a little bit, we'll add some powdered herb extracts and even bolster it up that much more. You don't even taste it with all the herbs and garlic and all the, I mean, it has such a rich flavor that, so if Carrie's still here, now we're gonna go on to mushrooms. Carrie, here's my mushrooms. And remember I told you, there's my mushroom pizza. All wild exotic mushrooms with my own Kamut ground flour that I make my own crust from. So white button mushrooms, portobello, shiitakes, crimini, morel, oysters, these are all potent immune modulators and cancer inhibiting properties. They're also thermogenic, they also aid in weight loss, so one of the best foods to eat. You know, you can pile up the mushrooms and you're getting virtually hardly any calories, and they're filling, they're satisfying. A portobello mushroom is very meaty and you feel like you've eaten something with sustenance. Here's all on shiitake mushrooms, improves circulation, prevents strokes, boosts health and wellness. And Carrie just had this awesome cooking class two nights ago on mushrooms here in their cooking kitchen, and she did a fabulous job and cooked all these different mushrooms all different ways, and maybe after this she'll have it again and more of you will want to come to it. But the shiitakes have a substance called lentinin, which has the capacity to treat chromosomal damage, and so it has a repairing mechanism to cellular health. It also reduces cholesterol. And this compound in shiitake is useful against hepatitis, heart disease, hypertension, infectious diseases, and cancer. And in vitro and in vivo studies on mushrooms and isolated compounds shown to have anti-tumor, redox modulating effects, antiviral, cholesterol lowering, blood sugar lowering. Several research papers have documented a correlation between dietary mushroom intake and a significant reduction in breast cancer. One study, the benefits were enhanced when green tea was consumed with it. White button mushrooms reduce aromatase activity. That's the other thing. I talked about aromatase. Mushrooms are the best food for lowering, naturally down-regulating aromatase. And then here is an in vivo study of mushroom extract on breast cancer, 7 days a week old mice. So mushrooms are tumor suppressing foods as well. So juices, here's the different juices that I like people to eat, and just samples because I customize everything. But I talked about the summertime, some of the foods, celery, cucumber, cantaloupe, watermelon, fresh lemon and ginger can be mixed in there, and even a little aloe vera juice. Those are really nice cooling juices. In the fall, for the liver and gallbladder, we do apple, carrot, beet, spinach, daikon, and lemon again. In the winter, I like people to freshly make pomegranate juice, not buy the pomegranate juice, unless it's like one of the ones that are sold only in the refrigerator, because when they ultra-pasteurize the berries, they kill off a lot of the phenolic compounds that have the medicinal value. So I give that one company, Palm Wonderful, credit because, you know, it must have been so hard for them to insist that they sell a juice that has to be refrigerated because that's so cumbersome. And the public isn't going to know the cost that goes into that. But they did that because they do a flash pasteurization because they knew they didn't want to destroy all the compounds in it. But the best way to make pomegranate juice is in Israel, the way I had it, and the way I even before I went to Israel, I was having all my patients drink it this way. On all the street corners, they juice the pomegranate fresh with an orange or a tangerine, and that juice is to die for and very, very medicinal. Yeah, that's what they juice, is the seeds. And the way you can do it at home without a juicer is you basically take the pomegranate and you roll it like it's a rolling pin, like you're rolling out a pie crust or something, and all the seeds will crush inside it, and so you'll feel them all crushed down. And you just put a hole in it, and you squeeze it all out, and it all comes out. One pomegranate, it's usually a whole glass of juice. It just comes out like there's no tomorrow. And I have a bunch of slides on how incredible pomegranates are, but they are one of the healthiest food. They're insulin sensitizing, have all kinds of phytonutrients in them. And I like the tangerine because the tangerine gives this interesting flavonoid called tangeritin, which has these unique cancer-suppressing compounds. One it targets E-cadherin, and E-cadherin expression is associated with reduced metastatic disease. So I talked about hyperthyroidism. I talked about in the nettles doing some of these spring green juices. I like the nettles with the carrot and a little bit of horseradish. Or if someone has a lot of congestion, you actually use fresh pineapple and juice the pineapple. And you can put a little fresh ginger juice in the pineapple. And it's very good, like springtime cleansing or summertime cleansing, if there's a little phlegm or congestion in the body. And so I talked about immunonutrition. So here's foods and concentrates that modulate immune function by either increasing innate immunity, natural killer cells, cytotoxic T cells, or acquired immunity, which is T cell response and B cell antibodies. So these modulate inflammation, promote healing, inhibit infection, suppress cancer and metastases. And they target the gut microbiome, the cellular defense system, and local and systemic inflammation.
Is that what immunotherapy is based on?
Well, immunotherapy in oncology now is based, again, on certain drug therapies, mostly what's called checkpoint inhibitors, some biologic agents, like the oldest one is BCG, which is actually, that's been around for 30 years for bladder cancer. It's actually a way of tricking the immune system. It's actually a form of tuberculosis that they give your body, and the body then responds to the vaccine, and by doing so creates enough cells that then go and attack the cancer cells. So it's a little way of tricking the immune system. And now they also, but the latest and greatest is looking at drugs that target the receptors on tumor cells that are immunosuppressive, because the tumor cell suppresses adversary cells to it. They have blocking mechanisms, and so they're designing drugs now that block those pathways. And then if you have a good immune system, your parts of your immune system then go and attack the tumor. Now they're very, very wonderful, and they're packaged very well with immunonutrition and immunobotanical medicine. We're going to be doing, hopefully soon, a clinical trial with advanced cancer with a checkpoint immunotherapy combined with our therapy.
This is going to be done at the Madeira Center?
Yes. Yeah, Madeira and Ohio State University. So three parts, and so a lot of these are fatty acids, mostly GLA and omega-3 fatty acids. I saw you use MCT oil. That's another aid to immunotherapy. MCT oil comes from coconut. We use coconut powder in the clinic, which is about 60-65% medium chain triglycerides. Basically, medium chain triglycerides give you twice the amount of energy with half the amount of caloric exchange. So when you're trying to spare caloric loss, like if you don't want someone to be eating their own body to create energy, MCTs are really nice because they're also almost like kind of a pre-digested fat. They don't take any stress for the body to utilize them as energy. They're very efficient for energy. So people that you don't want to waste energy in, they are very, very wonderful to use. So we use isolated amino acids, particularly patent forms like creatine, magnesium, glutamine, an undenatured whey protein, colostrum, fermented foods. Mostly all those things go into what we call the medicinal smoothie. Now, low levels of certain vitamins, low levels of vitamin D are increase all kinds of diseases. Recent study included 12,600 people found that low levels of vitamin D correlated with higher incidence of depression. And here you can see vitamin D and depression again, what we kind of reach for with vitamin D levels, and then even looking at food. So what are the best food sources of vitamin D? Obviously the sun is very, very important way, and the more skin exposed, the better chance you have. So if you go for a walk in the sun and you're all covered up with a coat and gloves and said, I've been out in the sun all day long, you're still not probably absorbing much D. If you're out in a bathing suit for 20 minutes, you're going to get a decent amount of D because it's all about surface. So the salmon is, this, particularly the skin, is really, really high in vitamin D. Sardines, shrimp, unpasteurized cow's milk is actually much better than pasteurized. A cod, but not a lot of great sources. Eggs are down there, and so it's one of the reasons why, you know, vitamin D is so deficient. You know, like 80% of the population's vitamin D deficient. And vitamin D is so correlates with reduction in incidence of various cancers. And then people with cancer that supplement and normalize their vitamin D have significant better response rates, longer response rates, and have better survival, significant better survival. Colon cancer and epidermal growth factor receptor treatment paradigm. So here is an interesting little diagram again, just showing you Western diet, basically poor eating, and poor eating basically activating these CXCR receptor 4, that refers to as chemokines, which are basically inflammatory cytokines that activate the cancer stem cells. And so chemokines are really something we want to buffer and reduce. And so when you eat badly, you eat foods in refined sugar, refined fats, that diet accelerates an inflammatory cascade. And already cancer is creating an inflammatory environment. So why do we have to cooperate with it? We want to try to not cooperate with it, create an environment that's not inflammatory. And so in all different ways, all these different factors. Here's curcumin interrupting inflammatory pathways there. Here's Tarceva, which is an EGFR inhibiting drug, green tea and ginseng, working synergistically with that agent. So these are omega-3s are one area of helping to control inflammation in the body, you know, and other fatty acids can help. What we want to do, cancer and most inflammatory diseases have high levels of PGE2, prostaglandin E2. And so we want to try to lower PGE2 and increase PGE3 and PGE1. And omega-3s help encourage PGE3. But other fatty acids and certain nutrients like magnesium, B6, and zinc are essential to normalizing prostaglandin balance. And what other nutrients besides vitamin D are so deficient in Americans and particularly cancer patients are zinc and magnesium. So zinc, magnesium, and D. It's not just vitamin D. And zinc is the most important nutrient for your immune system. Here's inflammation and inhibition by omega-3 fatty acids, fish oil targeting another inflammatory pathway in many diseases, TNF-alpha, including cancer. Foods that help reduce inflammation, well, here they all are, you know, and whole grains are great at inhibiting inflammation. where refined grains are very problematic, and then targeting the microenvironment by foods that don't encourage a thrombotic environment, in other words, blood clotting and blood stasis. So here we have tomatoes, garlic, ginger, onions, quinoa, natto, which is a fermented Japanese food, and nettles. They all have antithrombotic properties, and you can see here in discouraging platelet activation and aggregation, the stickiness of our platelets, not interrupting the clotting cascade by antagonizing vitamin K like a drug like Coumadin does, but really just, and not lowering platelets, just not allowing them to be as sticky and adhering to form that blood clot. And so all of these things here help to do that. So you can see how many different, and this is a complex, but this is all, you know, this is a look at food's influence on the rheology, you know, the cascade of blood rheology cascade. And you can see how many mushrooms here, tomatoes, olive oil, red wine, cocoa. I mean, it's just, you know, isn't it like how many different lenses you can look at food and apply it? It's just fascinating, you know, to me. And then here, the complex two-way relationship between food intake, mood, and obesity. In other words, the poorer you eat, the worse you feel. The worse you feel, the poorer you eat. You create a vicious cycle, and you have to block that cycle. And chronic stress and anxiety cause insulin resistance. Like I said, here is insulin resistance doubles the risk of breast cancer, doubles the risk. And causes here, glucose overload, refined sugar, refined starches found in most food, shortage of fiber, fewer legumes, you know, refined grains and breads and pastas, GMO, fat overload, poor quality fat, rancid vegetable oils, eating out poor quality food, missing from the diet. So it's not only giving your body all this poor quality food, but what are you missing now? Because you're not getting the good food. So when you eat poorly, you're giving food that stresses your body, that's not good for it, but you're also, you can only take in so many calories, your body's also missing on the food that would provide you with health. And so it's doubly as bad when you eat poorly. It's not just bad in one way. Insufficient secondary phytonutrients from fruits and vegetables, and additives in all of food too. And then foods are not only fast foods, but fast release foods. So we eat foods that cause, you know, lots of fast release, sugars and flours and corn syrup. 98% of grain production in the U.S. now contains GMO. And then the endocrine disruptors all in the food, and the loss of micronutrients. I mean, there's a lot of vanadium and zinc and chromium, all of these micronutrients. And then here is just, again, looking at food from a molecular perspective, looking at that relationship. And the drug Herceptin, which is a novel pioneer drug that's been around for close to 20 years now for breast cancer. And you can see here olives. Olive oil-rich diets relate to a significant reduction in all-cause mortality. Extra virgin olive oil potentiates the effects of aromatase inhibitors and of the drug Herceptin as well. And here are all the benefits of those polyphenols in olives, right here. Glucose balance, carbohydrate absorption, lipid metabolism, heart benefit, anti-obesity, liver benefit, liver inflammation, metabolic syndrome, basically. And then here is on oleoropin, one of the phenolic compounds in olive oil, and all of the health benefits. It's very good blood pressure regulation, control inflammation, oxidation, heart benefit, diabetes benefit, cancer. And this is all brand new. This is all from a brand new 2016 paper that just came out. And here's all the studies looking at the pathways with cancer, reducing angiogenesis. This is just on olives and olive oil. So, and then here is all basically specific cancer inhibiting compounds. The hydroxytyrosol, oleoropin, squalene, and oleic acid, all in olive oils, potentiating the drug therapies. And squalene is an incredible oil by itself. There's so many things I do with squalene, but it's great for the skin. You can buy it separate, and also I have people put it in their eyes for dry eyes. It's very, very nice for that as well. But olive oil is about 0.7%, or 0.2 to 0.7% is contained in olive oil. Here's on pomegranates. Probably going to go about 10 minutes more. Is that all right?
Mm-hmm.
And then that's and that will be
another
it.
Hour.
I have a plane to catch. Oh, you have a question now. On what? Did you have one?
I have a question. 100 plus years ago, the percentage of cancer deaths was like 1% of all deaths. A rather small number compared to our current level. And I'm trying to make a way for any of this information or all of this information to tell me why, what I can do that makes sense so that I don't get cancer by doing the things that are different now than we used to do it years ago.
Well, I think there are a lot of things you can do, but this talk is focused on what we can do mostly by how we can change our diet to reduce our risk, you know, and how we can feed our bodies better and what impact that would have on that. So that's the focus. But I think outside of food, there's a lot of different ways to analyze that and look back on that. And I think one thing is that people did die of other things back then that maybe they would have otherwise not died of today. That's one, you know, positive shift that's occurred. But I also do think cancer is evolving, it's growing, it's becoming more and more of a epidemic in our society, and all these factors that I've talked to have contributed everything, all the way from loneliness to what we eat, how we've been raised. You know, I wasn't nursed as a baby. I mean, there's just so many things to look back on, and then the genes that we inherit. My cousin has had for 25 years CML. He has the Philadelphia chromosome, so he got it in his 20s, basically, an abnormal chromosome. You say, well, you can't do anything about your genes. Well, if you look back, our grandfather was an Italian tailor, and they cleaned with benzene, and benzene was known to induce the Philadelphia chromosome. So there's a lot of reversing we have to do to get ourselves, you know, to a better state of health. We sleep an average of 1 hour less sleep than we did 100 years ago, even 50 years ago. 50 years ago, Americans slept one more hour every night than they do today on average. You add that up in a week, that's an entire day's worth of sleep that we're missing. So we're sleep deprived on top of everything else. So overstimulated, I mean, how much stimulated? You put on the TV, you watch a commercial, it's like stimulation beyond stimulation. And that alters the chemistry of every cell in your body to feel like it's in fight or flight all the time. And then the body says, what do I care about getting cancer? There must be a crisis all the time out there. And so the body is adjusting its set points to be better to meet the demands of stressors that we're all living with now and less concerned with what preserves our body for good health. You know the longest living species in the world? The tortoises from the Galapagos Islands. You know their average lifespan? 350 years. And they looked at them, and what they discovered is that they, no matter what, they don't get stressed. They even when they try to stress them, they still stay relatively calm, and their metabolic rate just is very slow. And I think we're all just like burning ourselves up, you know. So there are so many factors to how people lived back then. I mean, the pace was so much slower, and we're all like you know, on a conveyor belt, basically, you know, burning faster and faster, and it's not conducive to long life, you know, to a healthy long life. But anyway, we'll wrap it up pretty soon. Here's all the benefits: anti-obesity benefits of pomegranates, cancer suppressing, cardiovascular, hormone modulating. Do you know what they do in Egypt? You know how we throw rice when somebody gets married? You know, in Egypt and parts of the Middle East, they smash pomegranates when couples get married because pomegranates are considered the sign of fertility, all those seeds. And so they're very, very good for hormonal health. Here's the active compound, ellagic acid, being fed to mice, and tumor reduction going down, exerts a significant anti-angiogenic effect against breast cancer right there. And they're also found in raspberries, strawberries, cranberries, walnuts, pecans, and some other foods. And that one we had already.
Are you familiar with the Jarrow brand of pomegranate concentrate?
Yep, it's a pretty good brand. Okay. Yep. Jarrow. And let's see, here's the ellagic acid inhibiting one of the most known proliferative growth pathways called vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 2. That's ellagic acid's mechanism of working on it. Blueberries rich in all kinds of beneficial compounds, whole blueberry powder fed to mice and triple negative developed 70% fewer liver metastases, 25% fewer lymph nodes compared to controlled mice. So blueberries, amongst being good neurologically, being good cardiovascularly, and particularly good for the eyes, because in World War II, the English pilots ate loads of blueberries before they'd go out on night flights to better their night vision. They also have inhibitory effects on cancer. And the wild blueberries are better than the cultivated. Whenever you can get wild. One compound, delphinidin, and these, but also the richest source of delphinidin, which is another good cancer-suppressing compound, is currants. The little currants, those little raisins, they're very, very good. And then we had rhubarb last night, right? Yes. We had some rhubarb last night. So here, rhubarb is a great moisturizing laxative. Matter of fact, you can't eat too much because it's basically has laxative effects, but it's very moistening. So people that have dry stools and have issues around constipation, it's good. It is contains stilbin compounds. Stilbins are immune cytokines. You heard of resveratrol, that's an immune cytokine basically. It's a chemical the plant produces for its own immune system to protect itself against pathogens. So rhubarb has one of those stilbins, and what we find is when we humans ingest these plant protective compounds, they're protective to us as well. Imodin and renin are the active compounds in rhubarb that show anti-cancer activity. And here's Imodin demonstrating the ability to inhibit cancer. All the different mechanisms here. Renin also shown to inhibit the uptake of glucose of tumor cells. And here's, suppressing HER2-new signaling in combination with cisplatin and other chemotherapeutic agents. Reduce multi-drug resistance. Resulted showed Imodin and cisplatin co-treated remarkably elevated. So here it is. The Imodin helped elevate the reactive oxygen species. In other words, the combination induced more selective damage to the cancer cell. And it also enhanced the effects of gemcitabine, too, against human pancreatic cancer cells. So let's see. We got a whole section on soy, so let me go past them. Somebody had asked about chocolate.
Coffee.
So coffee, that's what it was, coffee. So let me get over to that. These are all the benefits of what's called phytoestrogens or isoflavonoids found in legumes predominantly. I have lots of slides on soy we can't get to, but I do have a great recipe that you'll get if you want it. This is the lemon broil tempeh recipe, one of my favorites that I make. Cancer inhibiting effects of nuts and seeds. Walnuts contain ellagic acid. Filberts contain taxines. Almonds contain benzaldehyde. Sesame seeds contain lignans. Pumpkin seeds are amazing. Pumpkin seeds are particularly inhibitory against prostate cancer as well. And Brazil nuts are the richest source of selenium. And here's on walnuts inhibiting cancer growth. Walnuts and flax seeds right here, the difference in the growth. And here's what you get when you get work with us is a recipe like this. All the things that would be in a protocol, as we call a protocol. And then here's the smoothie. So smoothie is a great way to get a lot of concentrated nutrition and all of your greens. We put our what's called food-derived vitamins and minerals, a multivitamin mineral with all the greens together. We call that Nutri-One. No synthetic or natural vitamins or minerals, all from food, fruits. And then here's me on Martha Stewart's show making a smoothie with her. And some of the things that go in our smoothies as well and how we prepare it. So, and then how important flax and chia seeds are to you. All the benefits of these, which can be ground up into a powder and put into the smoothie. Very inexpensive, both of these things. This was Sharon over in Italy, a dinner at Sharon's, Israel. She's an amazing natural food chef. And just one of the little dishes that she was creating in her home for us. And here's what we were eating while we were getting ready to eat the main course. This is cauliflower, roasted cauliflower, That's a guacamole and avocado dip. There's olives there on the plate, a little bit of wine. So really yummy. Here's me eating at Bellinson Hospital. Even in the hospital, I could eat a pretty decent meal. And my last section, because I have to do my section on whole grains, because whole grains contain a variety of important compounds that contribute to health and disease prevention. And here's all of the data. If you want to see scientific evidence, there's so much evidence, lots and lots of citations. Probably have over 50 papers on the health benefits of whole grains and how healthy they are for you to eat. 13 studies and total mortality. So whole grain intake and total cardiovascular and cancer mortality, a systemic review and meta-analysis of prospective studies. The findings support the recommendation of whole grains intake to improve public health. So if you want to do something, switch from refined food. And here's cancer, whole grain intake associated with reduced cancer rates. People that ate whole grains, less cancer. And here it is on dose response analysis between whole grains and risk of colon cancer. And here's on pancreatic cancer. And my favorite is kamut, which is the ancient grain. Kamut is one of the oldest non-hybridic grains. It's the one I use the most. And it's when they opened King Tut's grave, the only thing that was in the grave was kamut seeds. That's how much the Egyptians revered that grain. And I make my own bread. There is my flour mill. So on my counter at home, I buy no flour. I grind all my own flour. This is another one of my pizzas. And why is bread so important? So God rained down bread, manna, from heaven to sustain the nation. That's from Exodus. You know, when we think about flour, we have to think about the nutritional content. Socially, bread's the most important. Culturally, economically, the lowest environmental impact, and spiritually. And then they say, oh, but grains are inflammatory. Well, show me the data. Mean percentage of change of selective inflammatory cytokines based on how much eating kamut brought down inflammatory biomarkers. So again, just show me the data, because it doesn't. The data says just the opposite of what you're telling me. And then five tips from the Blue Zone: physical activity, clean environment, relaxation, rest, family, community, theology, and spirituality. And there we are in Italy with the Rosses. And I'm not going to even go through all the Blue Zones here and all the different things and how, you know, meat, you know, high meat intake, you know, red meat raises cancer risk and all of that, and greater consumption of fruits and vegetables. So we're coming to the end here. Sardinia again, a big family dinner there, and plant-based diets.
Is this all beautiful?
Yes, yes, yes. Nettles, my favorite food in the whole world, nettles. There's all the different dishes you can make from nettles. That's a nettles pesto. And my 10 important foods, these are some of the books, and then coffee here. So coffee is if it's organic, it can be very good for you in moderation. It's associated with reduced risk of many cancers, of better liver health, and better control of insulin. So the only two things I tell people when it comes to coffee, don't abuse it. It can be pretty acidic, and so try to have a lower acidic coffee if that bothers you. Drink extra water when you drink coffee, because it can be dehydrating. And always, when you can, have it be organic. We'll end kind of more, a little bit more on a prayer way, but feed the soul as well, for it too needs nourishment. Before you eat anything, ask yourself, does the food you eat come from love? Has it been prepared with love? And do you truly love the food? If you can say yes, then give it thanks to your Creator and proceed and partake. And here was a family from Syria that came, didn't speak any English, that we had over for dinner one night, sharing a homemade Middle Eastern meal at our home. That's in our home. And then finally, I'll leave you with a prayer. That's the moth orchid. That's a flower. I mean, such an incredible flower, you know. And it says, may God grant you always a sunbeam to warm you, a moonbeam to charm you, a sheltering angel so nothing can harm you, laughter to cheer you, faithful friends near you, and whenever you pray, heaven to hear you. So that's it. Thank you.